So now we are going to hear someone she loved unconditionally and cherished with all her heart, Riel, her son.
I grew up sitting at the top of our stairs on Jeanne Mance, listening to a lot of you. There are meetings held in our living room for all kinds of reasons. Editorial meetings, organizational meetings, board meetings, coalition meetings. While other kids watched TV and had parents with normal sounding jobs, I grew up playing volleyball in the streets, blocking bulldozers, and going to anti-nuclear demonstrations. My mother was a very determined woman. She had a quiet persistence about her, as you, many of you have alluded to, that was quite unavoidable. And when she put her mind to something, it inevitably bent to her will. Most of all, my mother was unapologetically principled. She never threw anything out. You never know when it might come in handy or we'll find a use for it, she would say. Show me something you need and I'll tell you how we made do without it for all these years. She would regale in saying to me whenever I wanted something material. You knew her as a housing activist, but what stood out for me was that long before it was fashionable to do so, my mother recycled everything. You need to understand that this took a lot of commitment in the 1970s. There were no blue boxes, and the idea of recycling was kind of foreign to most people. The very idea that someone would save all their orange juice cartons, styrofoam meat trays, and egg cartons seemed more than a little crazy at the time to some of us. Once or twice a year, she would show up at my school and would delight my teachers with all of her recycling. She'd give it to them and have us make art projects from the meat trays and egg cartons. Your mom's the garbage lady, I remember kids saying. That was really cool. Having a different sounding name wasn't very cool. Telling people your parents named you after a Canadian revolutionary got you beat up a lot. Not owning a car or a TV was weird. Having different anything is the last thing that you want when you're a little kid. My normal friends would go skiing at Mont Saint-Sauveur on the weekends. We'd go to Ottawa to protest the cruise missile testing. Cool. It wasn't until I was much older, of course, that I appreciated just how cool my mother really was. How progressive and principled she was, and how much of an impact she'd had on her community over the years. In closing, I'm going to read an excerpt from a speech made by Wilfrid Laurier in defense of Louis Riel. My mother asked that this be read at her memorial, and in researching it, I realized that it was her way of making me learn more about my namesake. And why my parents chose his name for me. Yet another good example of that determined persistence of hers reaching beyond the grave. It has been said that Mr. Riel was only a rebel. How is it possible to use such language? What act of rebellion did he commit? Did he ever raise any other standard than the national flag? Did he ever proclaim any other authority than the sovereign authority of the Queen? No, never. His whole crime and the crime of his friends was that they wanted to be treated like British subjects and not bartered away like common cattle. If that be an act of rebellion, where is the one among us who, if he had happened to have been with them, would not have been rebel as they were? Taken all in all, I would regard the events at Red River in 1869-70, as constituting a glorious page in our history, if unfortunately they had not been stained with the blood of Thomas Scott. But such is the state of human nature, and of all of and of all that is human. Good and evil are constantly intermingled. The glorious cause is not free from impurity, and the vilest may have its noble side. Thank you.
Now please welcome Lucia's lovely granddaughter, Natasha Free-Moussopoulos.
When I think of my grandmother, I think of when I was 12 and she and my papu took me to Europe with them. And when I was in Europe, I saw the way that everyone would just adore my grandma. We would go into a restaurant one night and the next day we'd walk by the same one and the owner would be calling out to her. And it was the same in basically every shop or tour we'd go on. She was so nice and showed everyone so much respect. And these weren't old friends either, she just had a way with people. I'd never seen anyone act like that before. Someone who was so kind and whom people were just automatically drawn to. When I was really young, I had always wanted to be just like my dad, Real, because I thought he was so funny. And he could always control whatever room he was in. And I realized on that trip that he got the ability to captivate people like that from my grandma. When we came back from Europe, I stayed in Montreal for a day while my papa was still in Greece, so it was just my grandma and I. And she asked if there was any food I wanted in the house, and while we were walking to the deli that day, I remember being stopped and greeted constantly by people. Everyone seemed to know her, and everyone would wave and call out her name or come to say hello. I think as a kid, it was difficult for me to conceptualize most of her projects and what she really did for the community. To me, she was my grandma. And everything she did seemed too abstract for me to fully understand. But being able to see the impact she had on people, just how much she was loved, it really struck me. And at the same time, I've seen her be so firm and so direct when fighting for people's rights. And I've never seen anyone else who is so capable of walking the line between being lovely and sweet, but also strong and demanding at the same time and always for the right reasons. I think it's incredibly difficult to do, and she did it so well. She's one of my role models for so many reasons, what she did for her community, but also just how kind she was and the way she showed respect for everyone around her. And that's what I was thinking about the day she passed away. How sad it was to have lost her, but also how lucky I was to have so many strong, powerful women to look up to in my family, and especially my grandma. Not many people get to say that their grandma is someone like her, that they're an amazing activist who did so much for their community and with so much grace and love. I feel really blessed to be a part of her family. In the same vein, I thought this quote my papu sent me, written by Lan Savoy after my grandma's passing, was really truthful. When I think of Lucia, I think of Russell Banks and his novel Continental Drift, where he writes, "We are the planet, fully as much as its water, earth, fire, and air are the planet. And if the planet survives, it will only be through heroism. Not occasional heroism, a remarkable instance of it here and there, but constant heroism, systemic heroism, heroism as a governing principle." Lucia brought that indomitable spirit and added a wonderful aspect of hope and kindness. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's incredible to see you all here. I once was in a play which I had to read. I was so vain that I thought I could print it in large print and not have to put my glasses on. I learned very quickly it's best not to be so vain. So forgive me. I realize I'm here kind of as a token American, and I appreciate that. But I will give you one. I'm not a Trump supporter, although I couldn't stand Hillary either, nonetheless. I'm amazed by what I've told so far. When my mother died, she had a large funeral as well. I left New York in 1970 to move to Boston. I'd known my mother all my life, and I didn't realize until that funeral how much I didn't know about my mother. And I've known Lucia since 1972 or three, I can't remember when we first met. And I met Dimitri first, and even though I met Dimitri first, I came back anyway, and then I met Lucia. And it's been a wonderful friendship ever since, I have to say. And now I've learned so much more about Lucia than I ever thought before. Living in Boston, of course, and not in Montreal, when I came here for the week or so that I would come every year, basically every year, it wasn't the political side of both Dimitri and Lucia that I knew best, although we did speak about it constantly. And we shared so many of the same ideals. What it was for me was the human side. I've learned through politics that a lot of people have good politics that I like, but I can't stand them. And I like to like people who have good politics whom I love. And that was Dimitri and Lucia for me. It also came as when I was talking with my wife to realize that I could not speak of Dimitri or Lucia. For me, it was always Dimitri and Lucia. And I guess it always will be, or Lucia and Dimitri, depending on which one I was with. I can't see them as just two different sides of the same whole. Really quite extraordinary. And we can stand here and we hear so much and we can be incredibly intimidated by Lucia's achievements. They seem, as Phyllis said, extraordinary, and others have said, almost superhuman. Every time I hear of them, of both Dimitri and Lucia. But nonetheless, Lucia would not have liked that, even though she would have enjoyed acknowledging it. So we're here to mourn a passing, but also to celebrate an extraordinary life. And indeed, in a sense, we mourn only because the life was so extraordinary. And every time I met them and I saw their achievements, before which mine certainly paled, I would always wonder and start to think about what is it that makes a life? We all get one, except for Shirley MacLaine, I guess, but we all get one. And it's the only one we have to work with. We want to make the most of it. And that's the challenge that Dimitri and Lucia always gave me, was how was I going to do the most I could with my life, seeing it as a project, my one chance, my one work of art that I could try to do something with. And Lucia taught me a lot of lessons. It was Dimitri and I would speak about the politics, about anarchism, Marxism, the rest of this, urbanism. But with Lucia, I was always speaking about people and about doing what was right for people. I can't remember many ideological conversations with Lucia over all these years, but always about projects and people. As you mentioned, in Europe and also here in Montreal, it was impossible to go anywhere without people constantly stopping her and or Dimitri. And Dimitri would talk about the next meeting usually and so on and so forth, and Lucia would ask about the kids and what you were doing. She knew something about everybody. It was a human touch. And so it was this humanism for me, just centering upon other people, on the conditions and choices that they were making, their search for meaning, especially in this kind of world where the tendency of our economic and social system seems to be to separate us, to atomize us, to alienate us, much rather, instead of quite bringing us together. And Lucia seemed to me to be able to do that, to bring people together. The feminist movement used to speak of that the personal is the political. I thought it was one of the great insights of the feminist movement for me, Feminism was certainly more of a challenge to me than the anti-racism movement or the anti-war movement when I was growing up, because it touched me in ways that were really personal and intimate. And I found that with Lucia, that in a sense, politics and the personal melded in her, they were one and the same for me, in part because of her commitment and her humanism that led her, in an almost religious sense, to value every human being, to see something sacred in life and to see something sacred in human beings. She understood that we were free to make our choices, but in a sense not free, because as an ethical person, she believed in responsibility and a sense of justice, something I learned. I had it already from my religious background, even though I'd abandoned it from my parents especially, but Lucia, I saw it so much. She understood that with freedom comes responsibility, and she chose to act in the public good without neglecting her family or her friendships and still being able to love people. I've known many people who act for the public good, but they abandon their families and their friendships are basically functional. And I have always despised that, been suspicious of it. But I never saw that with Lucia. Acting in the public good, all of her projects and her efforts, to my knowledge, were not simply for herself, but for the public good. I was thinking back the other day, actually I was reading a book on existentialism on the airplane, and they were talking about how the existentialists responded at the end of the Second World War, on, particularly the Catholic one, Gabriel Marcel, worried about what they call the spirit of abstraction, where people would forget about the human reality and center on politics, whether leftist or rightist politics. And to understand how many people are in a state of kind of abasement and alienation, people lack very often a sense of their own worth, except you know, perhaps in egoism. In our society, especially in the United States, many of us are essentially strangers to one another. This leads us places where we perhaps don't want to go. And so what Marcel and later Jean-Paul Sartre and others tried to do was to develop a kind of politics of humanism, a politics of the concrete. And to me, although I doubt Lucia ever read Gabriel Marcel, probably Sartre, that's what she was doing. And for me, it was the perfect combination of the human and the political in her. Trying to build and understand that it wasn't simply a political problem that we would solve by getting money or something as important as these things are, but it really was a social problem, a community problem, and for me, even wider, a cultural problem. To change the way we were looking at the world unconsciously, guided by our political and social leaders, perhaps even then unconsciously, but in particular by the way our economy functions. And so when she would speak of the Hôtel Dieu, she was speaking of place publique, right? And you're lucky I'm not going to speak any more French much more, although my accent was better than Lucia's. And this approach to her, neighborhood is not simply where people live together. You mentioned how Lucia tried to revitalize, keep going, how difficult it was, the Milton Park Community Board and so on and so forth, the need to revitalize it. Neighborhood means knowing people, not just being known. And Lucia would, as you say, everybody knew Lucia, and she knew something nice about everybody. And from neighborhood then comes community, a sense of belonging to something greater than the self, of fitting in this world. At the end of every semester, I teach at UMass Boston. At the end of every semester, I have to remind my students, at some schools, there are suicides at the end of every semester because of academic pressure. And we remind our students every semester that you're not alone. If you need help, there's someone there, because so many people lose that sense of community and feel that they are alone. Lucia never wanted anyone to feel that way. That was her work with the homeless, sans-abri, right? Sans-abri. Amazing work. And from that then comes a sense of citizenship and a much better understanding of what patriotism is. Citizenship, and you belong to a nation that's a community if you can get that far with it. Today, we hear neighborhoods, at least in the United States, New York, Nolita, Soho, in Boston, Soho, Nowa. We have all these neighbors. They're artificial. They're created to sell houses and condos in particular. And they're intentional. They're not organic communities. And Milton Park was, in a sense, intentional, in a sense, creative. Volusia worked so hard, in fact, and I think with an enormous amount of success, as I can see in the many shopping expeditions he sent me on. And when he was 12 years old, she used to send me out to get Riel. He's playing with those Portuguese kids over there. Go over and get him, and I would, and Riel would grab me and say, "Don't tell Mom I was watching television." And she used to send me out to buy fruits and vegetables when I was here, because they always treated me to a dinner, often staying at their houses, and she also knew I would pay for it. It worked both ways. I loved it. I loved it. I remember going to Louis Tucker. Some of you remember that, right? Picking my chicken, and they would wring its neck, not in front of me, of course, and we would have this wonderful chicken. But Volusia, community was a felt need, not a chic brand name. And Milton Park, for her, was not a chic brand name, as proud as she was of it. It was organic. It was her community. It was where she was rooted. And so she worked also to restore and to save Savon Montréal, which is a name I loved, became Héritage Montréal, which is a name I do not love, because they mean different things to me. Savon Montréal is different than Héritage Montréal. We have in Boston the same. We don't save the community, we save the buildings. But Lucia understood Hotel Dieu, as Phyllis understands and others, we're saving a community as well and making it public. In Dimitri, I believe, in some ways, most ways, she had a perfect partner. Again, I find it impossible to think of the one without the other. And as a result of this work was that the sense of abstraction was gone, and it was the concrete human. Politics became human. You understood what she was doing and why, as I did. And I've learned so much from listening to you all here. And so she had a set of principles, a series of guiding principles. And for Lucia, politics was as much about daily life, of course, and about ethics as it was anything else. And that, for me, was important. The older I get and the more I hear about different political arguments and fightings that people have and disagreements, the ethics, simply doing what's right. Here in Canada, you're fortunate. You have one of the greatest thinkers I've ever read. Always at Harvard half the time these days, is Charles Taylor from McGill. Really quite extraordinary. And in his book, Sources of the Self, he says many of us have an unadmitted adherence to certain life goods, such as in the West, such as freedom, altruism, and universal justice. And it is hard to see how one would have a moral theory at all, or indeed be a self, without some such adherence. And I think there's truth in that. There's truth in that. Now, freedom, altruism, universal justice, I hear that and I think of Lucia. She understood, many of us have heard here about how patient she was, and she understood that it wasn't going to happen quickly, it wasn't going to happen easy. No one understood more than Lucia what some of the forces opposed to this in our culture, not simply political forces, were and are. She could not eradicate hierarchy. She could promote equality, but not achieve full equality, perhaps. She could assist in the rise of democracy, much with Dimitri, who understands urban democracy better than I ever will. But once again, not theoretical. And so she asked me to read, again, as the token American, from a document that oftentimes in my country is perhaps, as with Hamlet, more in the breach than in the observant, right? From the Declaration of Independence. So I'd like to read that and then add just a couple of other remarks from Thomas Jefferson. As I mentioned to someone earlier, someone I have a great deal of difficulty teaching in my classes because of his views on slavery. Kind of ruins the man for me, but nonetheless, there was a greatness, at least to his words, if not his practice. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Those are wonderful words. And I think, as Dimitri said, that's Lucia. And she would certainly have insisted upon that people have the right to abolish and to alter their governments. That was her sense of revolutionary. But think about how it's based upon culture and upon ethics and a respect for other human beings. So I return again to my opening theme. Qu'est-ce que c'est un vie? What is a life? I don't know. But sometimes, as I'm getting older, I'm getting closer perhaps to understanding it, but sometimes it's a passing that makes us think most about a life and what we want to do with it and how much we appreciate what others have done. It's a universal question all human beings face, but again, now we face it again. Lucia, as we have seen, has given us an extraordinary for life, a blending of the personal and the political. As Jefferson put it, the Declaration was based upon a palpable truth that the mass of mankind has not been born with saddles on their backs, nor a favored few booted and spurred, ready to ride them legitimately by the grace of God. I read a piece this morning from Dinu Bumbaru. Some of you may have read it. I'll read a little bit of this and then I'll end. I apologize for taking so much time. He described Lucia as patiently impatient. Boy, was that true. Patiently impatient, willing to push for and sit through the years of meetings it sometimes takes to get civic issues to advance. He says, and I'm quoting, she was interested in fairness in society and compassion for the less favored ones, poor people, the homeless. But she also cared about the future, particularly the Hotel Dieu. She will be missed, he said. She left us with a to-do list that will help the sadness turn into inspiration. So, while I can control myself, I came here to help Dimitri to be the strong one so he could cry on my shoulder. And this morning, where was I, Dimitri? Crying on your shoulder. Thank you. And thank you, Lucia. Merci beaucoup.
Now we come to another song from the 60s.
See the song come true.
We shall live in peace.
Le directeur du Jour de la Terre, Pierre Lucier, à venir nous parler.
Dimitri, la famille, les amis. Le monde ne sera plus pareil sans toi, Lucia. We are going to miss the supernatural paper plane gliding above us. Tu vas me manquer, toi, la slameuse de velours de Montréal. Muse de Bono, rockstar des inadaptés. Le monde ne sera plus jamais pareil sans toi. Déjà, on le sentait venir lorsque tu faisais ta sieste sur mon sofa et que Martina, Dimitri et moi buvions du ozo sur la terrasse. Ce monde qui tend trop à ne pas changer, qui se rétrécit dans son interconnexion, bafoué au jeu du maintenant. Le monde ne sera plus jamais pareil sans toi, Lucia. Femme qui nous inspire tant de respect. J'avais juste besoin d'être à tes côtés pour tout à coup avoir le sentiment que ma vie faisait sens. Je voudrais tellement que mes filles te ressemblent. Toi qui n'avais pas besoin de t'affirmer pour être, grande technicienne de la compassion avec tes interventions tout en question. Être d'exception, lumineuse comme le blanc du canevas au centre des coups de pinceau. Jeanne Mance des temps modernes. The world won't be the same without you, Lucia, because you've infected everybody that cares about Milton Park with luminescence. And these tigris are now infecting millions. Le monde ne sera plus jamais pareil sans toi, Lucia, car tu l'as marqué ici comme ailleurs pour le meilleur. Et ici, à l'Hôtel Dieu, comme ailleurs, tu continueras de nous inspirer. Et tu sauras nous donner la force tranquille de continuer, beau temps, mauvais temps, à être acteur d'un monde plus juste et bon, verdoyant. So long, my friend. I've sewed my shooting star picture to my heart so you can recognize me when we see each other next time.
Maintenant, nous allons entendre une pièce qui s'appelle La Grande Porte de Kiev et une version au piano composée par Mussorgsky et jouée par Ashkenazy. Dimitri va nous lire un extrait du livre Militarisme et anti-militarisme. Et plutôt que de massacrer le nom de l'auteur, je vais le laisser.
La pièce qu'on vient d'entendre était de Mussorgsky. Et les instructions de Lucia, comme toujours, c'est très précis. Je ne veux pas la version orchestrale. Je veux la version piano. Et madame. Et en plus, je veux la version piano de Vladimir Ashkenazy. Oui, madame. Et c'est ça qu'on vient de voir. Comme j'ai dit au tout début, Lucia était également un pacifiste intégral, antimilitariste. Et elle avait quelques héros, imaginez-vous. Un de ses héros était Karl Liebknecht. Et l'autre, dans la même époque, était l'ami proche de Karl Liebknecht, Rosa Luxemburg. À un moment donné, Lucia a insisté que notre maison d'édition republie le grand classique de Karl Liebknecht, Militarism and Anti-Militarism. And that's what we did. Karl Liebknecht was the leader of the German Social Democratic Party. When his book was published, Liebknecht was tried and found guilty of high treason. The book was confiscated, and an order was given to destroy the plates from which it had been printed. Later, as a member of the German parliament, Liebknecht continued to agitate against militarism and refused to support the First World War. He was punished by being drafted into the German army. And in 1916, he was arrested for attempted treason and aggravated disobedience. His crime was to have dressed a demonstration in full military uniform, since he was still in the army, with these words, quote, "Our enemies are not the English, not the French, not the Russian workers, but the German landed gentry, the German capitalists, and their executive committee, the government," unquote. Karl Liebknecht was murdered by the German right wing, the Freikorps, along with Rosa Luxemburg. May his memory and Lucia's last forever. Let me conclude by saying that this formal part of our program today, over which we had no control. Well, something's wrong. We invited certain speakers to speak. But the musical program and the readings are Lucia to Aidy Kowalik. We will end with two pieces. One, the presto component of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy, which we sang all together in the Residence Saint-Georges, holding hands, when Lucia died. And she loved this piece as we all love it. But what was important to note also is that Lucia used to sing it in the choir in Albany and elsewhere and in Germany. And there she was in her bed in the Residence Saint-Georges, and I would play that to her. And where she found the strength, I don't know. But she would burst out in German with the words. That's what we're going to hear. And the final piece we're going to hear, because like all of us, Lucia was a virulent, virulent anti-fascist. And the last piece we're going to hear is that by exemplary conductor Arturo Toscanini, who in 1944, when fascism in Italy was finally defeated in the fields, including by her uncle James, by the way, who was part of the American army that went into Italy to wipe the soil clean of Italian fascism. We're going to hear Arturo Toscanini conduct the Internazionale in 1944. In a special concert that he and the New York Philharmonic held in New York. And it is particularly poignant because it was banned by US authorities.